أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته Thank you to everyone for joining us this afternoon or evening depending upon where you are in the world I hope you've had an enjoyable Eid a belated Eid Mubarak to you all We are very fortunate to have Professor Recep Şentürk here with us today, joining us from all the way from Istanbul in Turkey. And he will be helping us to answer the very important question, what makes education Islamic? Now, perhaps we think we know the answer to that question, but I ask, please, let's keep an open mind, inshallah. And inshallah, over the course of the next half an hour to 40 minutes, Professor Recep will be presenting his point of view, inshallah, and then we will have an opportunity, all of you, to ask questions, inshallah. Just to give you an introduction to Professor Recep Şentürk, if you've not met him before or you've watched him before. Professor Şentürk completed his undergraduate education in the Faculty of Theology at Marmara University, which is in Turkey. He completed his postgraduate degree in sociology in the Faculty of Letters at Istanbul University. And became an assistant in the same department. He pursued his PhD in sociology at Columbia University in New York, USA. Between 1998 and 2007, he was researcher at the Center of Islamic Studies. He has been the director of the Alliance of Civilizations Institute since it was founded. In addition, he has been the general coordinator of the Istanbul Research and Educational Association in Istanbul for 7 years. Currently, he is the president of the Ibn Khaldun University in Istanbul. He did research on human rights as a visiting scholar in the Faculty of Law in Omori University, Atlanta. He continued his research on human rights as a guest of the British Academy and the Faculty of Social Sciences and Law at Oxford Brookes University. And he lectured on the same topic in various universities in the UK. He is married with 4 children and speaks English. Turkish, Arabic, Persian, French, and German. Wow, mashallah. So we'll only be asking him to speak in English today, though. This webinar will include a presentation by Professor Recep Şentürk, followed by questions from the virtual floor, which is yourselves. During Q&A, you can either raise your hand, okay, by pressing one of the icons where you raise your hand or thumbs up. Or what I think is a little bit better is if you write the word speak, S-P-E-A-K, in the chat box, and then I will unmute you for you to ask your question. I always prefer verbal questions over written ones, simply because the written ones disappear very quickly in the chat box. So I will be giving preference to those who want to ask verbal questions. We do aim to end, I say shortly after 5 p.m., because today, because there are so many of you in the room, mashallah, right at the very beginning, clearly, Professor Recep, a very popular speaker. I had to make sure that you were all in before we started. So we do aim to end around about 5 past 5, inshallah. And so it is going to be quite succinct. Okay. So first of all, how are you, Professor Recep? Let me unmute you. That's unfair. Let me unmute you. Yes. How are you?
Good. Alhamdulillah. How are you?
MashaAllah, very good. How is everything going on in Turkey, in Istanbul, with all the lockdown and the COVID-19?
Alhamdulillah, you know, everything is under control. And alhamdulillah that Ramadan coincided, you know, with the restrictions for the coronavirus, period. So alhamdulillah, we are all doing well. But we are going through strange times, and I offer my belated Eid greetings to everyone in the audience. And inshallah, you know, next Eid will be better than this one.
Inshallah. Okay, now, for the first time in our series, and this is the 6th webinar in the series, we've not had 95 people in the room before we even started. So we're looking to break the 100 record for our series. So I know that our audience members are probably thinking, Barbara, please be quiet. We want to hear from the professor now. So over to you, inshallah, and then we'll talk a little bit later on, inshallah. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, assalamu alaikum everybody. From I offer you my best greetings from Istanbul. Please accept my belated Eid greetings for Eid al-Fitr. May Allah accept your fasting and all other good deeds that you have done during Ramadan. One of the best good deeds that we can do is to offer Islamic education to our children and younger generations. And I see that there are many efforts around the world, you know, to offer education, Islamic education to youngsters. However, the question, what makes education Islamic, is not so clear. I observe that you know, many of our schools simply hang Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, you know, at the entrance of the school, and they think the school became Islamic. And the issue is more complicated than this. Or simply teaching children to make salat, and the girls like to have hijab, makes the whole school Islamic. I believe that you know, there are deeper questions beyond this issue. So I will share my views with you on this issue. Yes, I see that today most of our schools use the existing educational models, which are based on a secular and positivist understanding of science. So this creates an inconsistency, a paradox. Can we offer Islamic education by adopting secular positivist educational models? And I think adopting the existing Western education models, which are based on, you know, secular, materialist, and positivist world views, makes the non-Western world intellectually, academically dependent on the West. And intellectual independence, academic independence, requires relying on Islamic education models. So this is very important for the Muslims to gain intellectual independence, you know, from the positivistic, materialistic educational models. But this brings up the question of what are those Islamic educational models, and how can we judge objectively whether an education is Islamic or not? So we need to develop objective, clear criteria to judge, you know, whether an education is Islamic or not. And I will offer you 9 criteria in my talk to objectively judge whether an education is Islamic or not. And once we have these 9 criteria in place in our schools, then we can say, okay, this is a truly Islamic school, and it truly offers Islamic education. Why would be a problem to adopt the dominant educational models? So let's look at the major characteristics of the dominant educational models in the world today, in Europe and in America. And so this will help us highlight why it's a problem, you know, to adopt the existing education models in our schools. And why, if we adopt these models in our schools, our education cannot be Islamic. The first major characteristic of the dominant education models is that in their academic education, you know, they follow the positivist worldview. by positivist, I mean the materialist and the atheist world view. So this is a big problem, because if you teach sciences, you know, from a materialist and atheist perspective, how can you call your education Islamic? So you have to change this. And the second, when it comes to character education, because schools offer two types of education, one academic education, the other is the character education. And today, in the dominant educational models, liberal ethics, you know, is offered to children, and it's based on the autonomy of the individual, you know, free from religion, free from God, you know, free from any authority, free from society. So this the positivism combined with liberal ethics alienates students to God, to society, to family, and it disconnects them from the metaphysical world, from God, and from society, from religion, from family. And another major characteristic of the dominant education models is that it is very Eurocentric. And by Eurocentric, I mean that it presents European values and ideas as if they are natural and universal, as if materialism is natural, atheism is natural, liberal ethics is natural and universal, and like a secularization process is natural, and all societies must follow the same process, you know, European societies experience there. So this is what I call Eurocentric view, and especially in social sciences, philosophy, history, sociology, you see this Eurocentric view. And from this perspective, you know, Western experience is presented as the most progressed, most developed, and the rest of the world either presented as primitive or underdeveloped. Another major feature of the dominant education models is that it's commercialized. And education is seen as a business, and knowledge is treated as a commodity, you know, to make a profit from. So these are the four major characteristics of the dominant education today in the world, in particular in Europe and America. So in this context, we need to ask nine questions to critically analyze our schools and our educational systems. So the first one, what's the goal of Islamic education? Second one, you know, how can we combine academic and character education in our schools? The third one, what's the worldview of Islamic education? You know, because this worldview underpins the education of natural subjects, language and literature, and social subjects and religion. So that's why it's very important, you know, to clarify, like, what's the worldview of Islamic education, because our schools must offer, you know, Islamic worldview to the students, so that you can call it Islamic education. Otherwise, if you offer, you know, a materialistic or Western, you know, worldview, you cannot call it Islamic. And how should the teacher and student relationship be structured, you know, in our schools, so that we can call it Islamic? And the fifth important question is, how can we relate to Islamic heritage? You know, how can we teach Islamic history and civilization heritage to our students? And the sixth major question is that how should a future vision of Islamic civilization be taught? I mean, we have to teach our students a future vision what kind of future vision we should offer to our students. And the seventh question is how to relate to the modern positivist science, because it's the dominant hegemonic science discourse. What should we do, you know, with respect to it? Should we ignore it completely and reject it, or should we adopt it wholesale? What should we do? You know, this is another major question. And the eighth question, how should we finance our education, you know, our educational institutions? How should they be financed? So this is very important for the education system, and it has direct impact on the content of the education and the relationship between the students and the school. And the final important question, what should be the role of ISNAD, you know, in the education system? By ISNAD, I mean the chain of scholars, you know, leading to Prophet Muhammad, because, you know, traditionally, this was part of our educational system, and every teacher, every student was connected to Islamic intellectual tradition, Islamic academic tradition through the ISNAD system. And ISNAD system was a tool to preserve the social, academic, intellectual memory. So what should be the role of ISNAD? Because in the modern educational system, there is no ISNAD. You know, that's a big difference between Islamic educational institutions and the modern Western institutions. So what's the role of ISNAD in this context? So these are the nine critical questions if we want to analyze our schools and the education we are offering to the students. So now in the rest of my presentation, I will try to answer these nine questions and offer criteria for each question to judge whether, you know, an education system is Islamic or not. So the first one is the first criterion is about the goal of education. Okay, so what's the goal of education in your school? So this is very important. So Islamically, the goal of education is accepted as raising al-insan al-kamil, the ideal human being in Islam. And the most ideal human being in Islam is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then his companions, then the successors, and you know, people who followed his sunnah in the following generations, in the subsequent generations. And the purpose of Islamic education is to raise insan kamil, you know, people who follow the role model of Prophet Muhammad, alayhi salatu wassalam. But in the modern world, majority of the schools adopt the goal of raising professionals, people who can get jobs with the help of education they receive from the schools. So insan-ı kamil is a goal higher than simply raising professionals, you know, who will get a job and make some money. Of course, the ideal human being in Islam has a profession and knows how to make a living, but he cannot be reduced only to a professional, you know, whose only goal is to make money. So it's beyond beyond that. So if the goal of your school educational institution is to raise al-insan al-kamil, then, you know, you have the first criteria in place in your school. Okay, so the second criterion to objectively judge whether an education system is Islamic or not is holistic education. By holistic education, I mean combining academic and moral, you know, spiritual education or character education. So these two must be combined in order to raise al-insan al-kamil, the ideal Muslim, the ideal human being, character education, as well as the moral education, character education and the academic professional education at the same time. Traditionally, these are called ta'lim and tezkiye as complementary methods. As you all know, Prophet Muhammad, he is the first teacher, first educator and instructor in Islam, and his role methods are mentioned in the Quran as follows: يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. So two words occurs in this verse: ta'lim and tazkiyah. Ta'lim is for the academic education, rational education, and tazkiyah is for moral education, character education, and spiritual education. So in the Quran, in several places, it is mentioned that Prophet Muhammad used these two methods, ta'lim and tazkiyah, rational education and character education, to raise the Sahabis. And these two methods have been used, you know, in Islamic education throughout generations until we westernized, secularized, and modernized our education system. Now we need to reform the methods we are using in our education and adopt a holistic education if we want it to be Islamic. And the third criterion is about the worldview. So what type of worldview is offered to the students through education? Presently, the science education that we offer to our students is based on materialist worldview. And in that, in the materialist worldview, there is no alam al-ghayb. There is no malakut. There is no God. So it's reductionist to the material level. But by multiplex, I mean a worldview that accepts the existence of the material world and also the existence of the metaphysical world and also existence of Allah Ta'ala. So there are three major levels of existence, yani mulk, malakut, lahut, or alam al-shahada, alam al-ghayb. You know, these are the terms used in the Quran. So Islamic worldview is based on the understanding that there are multiple layers of existence, the material world and the non-material world and the divine world. So this worldview must provide the foundation for our teaching of natural sciences, social sciences, language, and literature. And the same way, our epistemology, which is our approach to sources of knowledge, also multiplex. It has multiple levels of it. So we accept that we can gain knowledge through sense perception, through empirical methods, as well as through rational methods, and also through divine revelation, wahi. So this is the multiplex epistemology, which accepts, you know, multiple levels of sources of knowledge. And the same thing for the methodology. The Islamic view, the Islamic worldview accepts that there are several methods to have access to knowledge: empirical methods, rational methods, and also interpretation, understanding of the divine revelation. So it is not reductionist. It is multiplex and comprehensive. So if you want our education to be Islamic, we have to apply this criteria and replace the materialist reductionist worldview with a multiplex worldview with respect to existence, knowledge, and method. And the fourth criterion is about the student and teacher relationship. In the present educational systems, teacher and student relationship, it's professional in the sense that you know, they are formally linked to each other, but Islamically, you know, the relationship between the teacher and the student is personalized. You know, there is a respect and there is a love, you know, between the two, and there is care between the two. You know, teachers adopt their students as if they're as though they the students their own children, and education is offered on one-to-one basis to the students, because students sometimes share like many features, but each student is different in some aspects. So education needs to be customized, you know, to fit each student, and this is how it was offered traditionally in our educational system. And today, you know, we have to go beyond the professional formal relationship between teacher and student and make it more personalized, customized, to make that relationship an Islamic teacher and student relationship. So the fifth criterion to judge whether, you know, an education is Islamic or not is the approach to history. You know, how we are looking at Islamic history from a Eurocentric perspective. Islamic history is a backward history, and Islamic civilization declined. So there is no use, you know, in studying Islamic history. However, I think that you know, our historical vision must be rooted, you know, and we have to value what Muslims did in history. Of course, we are not adopting a completely conservative view is not a good idea, you know, because society always keep changing. So the method should be rooted revivalism. You know, on the one hand, it should be rooted in Islamic civilization and history, but at the same time, should be revivalist. So this is what the tradition called tajdid or ihya, and this is part of our philosophy and world view. At the moment, there are two major options, you know, when you look at Islamic history and civilization. One is that the chain of social memory, the chain of intellectual history is not broken. It continues until today. In every age, there was like a great scholars, you know, who authored great books, and this chain of scholars and authorities continued from the beginning until today. So this is one view which I share. And the other view is that you know, there is a disruption in Islamic intellectual history. So in the beginning, there was golden age, and then dark ages, you know, until today. And in those dark ages, Muslims did everything wrong, everything went wrong. So there is nothing to value, appreciate, or respect, you know, a lost millennium. So people, you know, reject Islamic civilization and Islamic legacy based on various reasons, Some says it's bid'ah, some says it's backwards, some says it's irrational. So they reject the Islamic heritage we inherit from history. So the two views, but I believe that if an educational system rejects Islamic civilization, the legacy of Islam, then it cannot be Islamic. I mean, it should be rooted, but at the same time, revivalist. So this rooted historical vision is another criterion to make education Islamic. And the sixth criterion is about what kind of future vision you are offering to your students in your school. Is the future vision you are offering, you know, an Islamic future vision or not? So this is very important. And I call the civilization vision of Islam as open civilization, in the sense that you know, Islam is for all human beings in the world, because it's based on the Adamiyyat. The Adamiyya, like every human being, you know, is under the care of Islamic religion and civilization, and there's no compulsion in religion. And when you look at Islamic history, this is how Islamic civilization was practiced. In India, Buddhists and Hindus lived under Islamic rule. In Andalusia, Jews and Christians lived under Islamic rule. So this how it will be in the future as well, an open civilization, but based on Islamic worldview, Islamic values. And the seventh criterion is about our relationship with the materialist science, or the Western science, the positivist science. What kind of relationship are we going to have with the existing science discourse and scientific endeavors and discoveries in order to understand this, we have to first understand what science is about. So science has two components. One is the data, the other is the interpretation of the data. Okay, so when we approach to the modern materialist science, we have to be aware of this. You know, there is data and the interpretation of the data. I mean, the data is like more natural and more objective. Of course, sometimes they play with the data as well, and we have to be aware of this. But interpretation is very relative, very subjective. You know, if someone is a materialist, it interprets the data from a materialist perspective. So if someone believes in God, you know, it interprets the data from that perspective. For instance, you know, there are discoveries in genes, let's say, and the atheists claim that the discovery of genes demonstrate that there is no God. And those who believe in God, they say, oh, discovery of these genes demonstrate that there is God and it has endless knowledge and power. So you see that you know, we have to dissect the science discourse, separate the data from the interpretation, and we should be critical but fair, you know, in our approach. So we accept the data, we accept what's empirically proven, but we reject the materialist interpretations. So we can have our own interpretation, because interpretation is very subjective and relative to the worldview of the scientist. So this is how we relate ourselves to the existing positivist materialist science. So we accept whatever empirically proven in the labs, or based on the objective observation, but we critically analyze and assess the interpretations offered. So this is another criteria, you know, to see whether education is Islamic or not. But if you accept wholesale the materialist science discourse and offer it to your students, then you cannot claim your school is Islamic or the education you are offering is Islamic. You have to teach this critical but fair approach to the existing science discourse. And the ninth and the eighth criterion, you know, for the education to be Islamic is that it should be non-commercial. You know, and traditionally, you know, knowledge is seen sacred in our civilization and religion, and all educational institutions were non-profit organizations, and they were funded by awqaf, by waqf endowments. And so today we have to resist commodification and commercialization of education. So Islamic education cannot be a business. It cannot be a commercial activity. And the ninth and the final criterion is how you connect yourself to the chain of isnad. You know, and isnad, as I have mentioned, the chain of authorities linking us, you know, to Prophet Muhammad. So this was very important in Islamic civilization. And actually, every diploma in the, Islamic education had a chain of authorities, you know, between the teacher who issued this diploma and the Prophet Muhammad. So this is something uniquely Islamic. So Islamic civilization is not civilization. This also needs to be revived if you want our education Islamic. So our diplomas should be different than the diploma educational institutions. Of course, this is not easy to apply today, but in especially in Islamic and social studies, this is very easy. All right, so the nine criterion, I would like to repeat all of them once again. If you want to reform our education institutions and make them truly Islamic, first, set the goal of education as raising insan kamil. Second, combine academic and character education by using the methods of ta'lim and tazkiyah as complementary methods. Third, revive multiplex worldview, you know, based on multiplex ontology, epistemology, and methodology in the study of nature, society, and language. Fourth, revive personalized or customized education based on one-to-one education and relationship between teacher and student. Fifth, highlight the continuity of Islamic civilization and sciences. Sixth, offer past and future vision of Islam as open civilization. Seventh, accept empirically proven facts from modern science, but interpret them from an Islamic perspective. Eighth, finance education through institutions of foundations, like charitable institutions, and resist commodification and commercialization of education. Ninth, maintain the Isnad tradition in appropriate fields, in particular Islamic disciplines such as Hadith. So thank you very much. This is how I end my my presentation. Now I am ready to address your questions and objections and contributions. Thank you.
MashaAllah, Jazakallah khair. Thank you so much, Professor Rajab. So much information in such a short time. And normally when this happens, our heads start to buzz, and my head is buzzing a little bit now, thinking about those nine those criteria that you've listed. MashaAllah, Jazakallah khair. Okay, we have a number of questions that are coming through. Okay, so we will go one at a time, inshallah. I do apologize in advance if we can't get your question, answer your questions within the time frame. So please ask it now. Don't wait until the end, because you're unlikely to get a chance. Let's go to Sister Farah Ahmed, Dr. Farah Ahmed, who's from London, and I will unmute her mic now. Over to you, Sister Farah.
Assalamu alaikum, Professor. It's lovely to hear you speak. We met briefly, I think, last winter, alhamdulillah.
Yes.
Yeah, no, it was just fascinating listening to your talk. Jazakallah khair. Alhamdulillah, I can report back that at least in our school, I think we've covered all 9 of your criteria. So I'm very pleased about that, alhamdulillah. But I had a question about 2 of your criteria. The first one being insan al-kamil, that is the goal. And the fourth one where you talked about personalizing education. So one of the things that we've been working on in our schools is theorizing the ideal character, obviously as the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but maybe breaking that down into understanding it as shakhsiya, with the idea that we focus specifically on individual children's unique personalities. So Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala created us all very different. Because if you try and put the aim as we all need to be like the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, sometimes that takes away that we're all trying to be the same. Whereas the understanding that we've developed is that Allah created us all uniquely, and it's all about enhancing our fitrah and our unique character to be as much like the Prophet, but to be different, to be ourselves. And then what that does is bring out that personalized relationship and that personalized learning. And that when you're talking about shakhsiyah as the goal, the goal is very specific for that specific learner, that specific child, and where you are taking them, as opposed to a general goal. So I'm just wondering what your comments on that would be, and how those two things interact, those two criterion.
Yes. So Allah Ta'ala created each human being differently, but at the same time, similarly. You know, so we share many things in common, but at the same time, we have unique features. Islam also offers us some universal values, some universal principles to be shared and practiced by everybody. But at the same time, individual values as well. And this is very much reflected in the way we make salat. You know, like when we make fard, like everyone follows the imam, right? But then we make sunnah. I mean, everyone goes separately, right? So there's community and individual at the same time. So there is a balance between the two. And the best way, I believe, to develop a character of our youth is to revive the Futuwa tradition. The Futuwa tradition, you know, and Abdurrahman al-Sulami has a very nice book, and it's translated to English as well. But the title is kind of misleading, because they put the title like a Sufi chivalry. I mean, it should have been altruistic character, altruistic morality, because futuwa means karam, you know, that means hospitality. It means altruistic morality. So instead of selfish, individualist, liberal ethics, you know, we should offer altruistic futuwa ethics. And mashallah, like our scholars, pedagogues in Islamic history, they codified those values. They made a list of them, so that it becomes easy, you know, for the teachers to identify them, as well as for the students to learn them. So this is what I propose. And at the same time, insan-ı kamil does not mean someone who does not make any mistake. Insan-ı kamil is not infallible. You know, insan-ı kamil is not Pope or the Imam Masum. You know, insan-ı kamil follows the role model of Sayyidina Adam and Sayyidina Hawa. You know, so they made a mistake and they apologized, right? So insan-ı kamil is the person who can make mistake, but at the same time ready to accept the mistakes and to correct them. All the prophets in the Quran and the sahabis and the great scholars, leaders in Islamic history, they are offered in the futuwa tradition as role models, you know, to the young people. So in those books, it says, be like Adam. When you make a mistake, apologize. You know, be like Hawa, you know, do this. Be like Ibrahim. Even if you are threatened by fire, stand up for the right thing. Be like Moses, you know, speak up the truth. You know, their role models are used both men and women, you know, from the Quran and also from the time of the Sahabis. So I believe this is the best, you know, tool for the shakhsiyye education, inshallah, for our youth. Thank you.
Jazakallah khair. Thank you so much. Let's go straight to Abu Hafs. I've unmuted your mic.
Assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum salam.
Ayros, inshallah. Thank you, Professor Rajab. It was a very beneficial talk. Just, I wanted some advice from you, please. How important do you think the teacher's role or the personality of the teacher counts towards Islamic education? I just wanted to give you a quick example. For example, let's say, like you said, it's Salah time. So the teacher is praying with the students. And then after the Salah, let's say the teacher, for example, they stand up and they begin to talk. And maybe the children see this, that, oh, the teacher is not praying the sunnah. The teacher is not making dhikr. The teacher is not making dua. Do you think that the character of the teacher or the Islamic teacher in this context is important? And if it is important, like, what could we do? What steps could we take as teachers to make ourselves even better for the students?
Yes. So this is a very important question, because actions speak louder than the words. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, he taught by setting an example. You know, that's the meaning of sunnah, right? Sunnah means, you know, role model. Sunnah means example. So he, you know, presented a role model, and his students, the Sahabis, they followed his role model. And the teacher in Islamic tradition is defined as al-kamil al-mukammil. You know, the ideal, and at the same time, the one who can raise the students to the ideal level, perfect and perfecting. You know, so the teacher must have this ability. You know, he must be perfect himself, reflecting the ideal moral and professional and academic qualities, but at the same time, he should have this ability to install these good characteristics to the student as well. So not every Kamil is Mukammil, you know, because someone may be a very good person in himself, but he might not be able to teach things to others. So he's considered not a good teacher. You know, al-kamil and al-mukammil. So, and this is called takmil, you know, perfecting, elevating students to academic perfection, to academic excellence, to moral excellence. So, the most important method is the sohbet. Sohbet means spending time together, socializing, and setting a good example. And the students learn from the role model by observing the role model. So they say that if a teacher does something to teach the students, this wouldn't be riya. This wouldn't be riya. Yes, because you know, he's doing this to demonstrate, you know, to them, so that they can follow the role model. So if you do things, you know, just to show the students this is what was the right thing to do, then it's not considered to be the riya. Yes, so only the kamil and mukammil people can raise insan kamil. Thank you.
Shukran, thank you so much. Professor Rajab, we've got a third question here from Brother Atola Parker, who I believe is tuned in all the way from UAE. Over to you, Brother Atola.
Yes.
I've unmuted you. Yeah, there you go.
Assalamu alaikum. Professor, thank you so much for your wonderful insight. We had the honor of meeting you on the Nida trip in 2016 with Brother Baba, and I'm just seeing Brother Idris's face. So happy to see you, mashallah. I just you've mentioned lots of different sciences in your discussion so far that you know, that leaders, at least leaders in Islamic education, need to be acquainted with. You've mentioned connection with the Senate. You mentioned Tazkiyah, social sciences, natural sciences, ontology. You know, if you were to package that up and give some recommendations of things that we should be grounded in, disciplines that we should be grounded in, what are the sciences that we need to be well grounded in to be able to deliver a good Islamic education?
Yes. So there are books talking about everything I talked. Sometimes they are called Adab al-Ta'lim wal Adab al-Ta'lim wal Muta'allim. You know, and Imam Ghazali has some books on this issue. Zarnuji is another one who has books on it. And so please check the books on Al-Ta'lim wal Muta'allim. Ta'lim wal Muta'allim, Adab al-Ta'lim. You know, and also in the hadith books, in Kitab al-Ilm, you find the etiquette of this. But my presentation is very comprehensive. I try to draw your attention to every aspect of education, from financing, you know, to teacher-student relationship, to the way diploma is given, and the way you know natural sciences are offered, etc. So you know, this is a full like I am attempting to draw your attention to a complete understanding of the educational system and how can we reform it and make it Islamic. So it's not about like what you need to read, you know, to learn more about Islam. But education has always been a central issue in the writings of Muslim scholars, and there are always, you know, chapters and particular books dedicated to this issue. Like in hadith books, you can read Kitab al-Ilm, and in tafsirs, you can read the verses talking about ta'lim and tazkiyah. يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. You can read the tafsir of these verses, you know, from the major tafsirs. And also books of scholars like Imam Ghazali and Zarnuji and others. You know, these books will help you about the adab of ta'lim. Thank you.
Shukran, thank you so much. Let's move straight on to the next question. We have Brother Amin, all the way from Malaysia. Brother Amin, I've unmuted your mic. There you go. Over to you.
Assalamu alaikum, Prof.
Alaikum salam wa rahmatullah.
Okay, very briefly, I'm just like to refer to your criteria number 4, which is about personalized and customized education. I'd like to you to elaborate a little bit more about that, because it could give the impression that the each student will have only one teacher, so that the teacher will give a personalized and customized education to that person, to the student. So but that would not be quite possible in our education system nowadays, because we have so many students in the school. So we need to you know, give them education as a group. So can you elaborate a little bit more
yes.
about that personalized and customized
yes,
education?
Yes, yes. Yeah, this is a big challenge in front of us today, because there is a big shift, you know, in the structure of Islamic education institutions. So in the past, you know, students in those madrasas, they were taught on one-to-one basis. You know, like we had Ottoman madrasas, you know, in Istanbul and Anatolia. Every student was taught by a major, by his major teacher on one-to-one basis. But at the same time, there were halaka lessons, like many students, you know, sat in those halakas. But this is, you know, this is not the principle. Education. The principal education was carried on one-to-one basis. But today, as you said, you know, we have great population, big numbers of students. What are we going to do? I believe we have to combine, you know, one-to-one education with this mass education together, because you know, mass education completely ignores, you know, special needs of individual students. So this is not a good quality education. I mean, so even though we cannot offer every student one-to-one education, I mean, we can make like some special sessions, you know, like one-to-one education between the teachers and the students, like kind of mentoring or supervising, you know, like at Ibn Khaldun University, we wrote on the wall, no bird will be forced to swim in the school, and no fish will be forced to fly in the school. Okay, you know, so you know, you have fish and bird. You have to give them, you know, a separate education, right? You know, customize. You know, they have certain things in common, but you know, don't force the fish, you know, to fly, and don't force the bird to swim. So this is what I mean by a customized education, and also this relationship between teacher and student. You know, it should be a love relationship, a care relationship, a respect relationship. You know, there should be an etiquette, you know, between the muallim and the muta'allim. And this etiquette should be based on, you know, Islamic values and principles. This is what I mean by this. Thank you.
Shukran, thank you so much. We've got the final two questions. We have Brother Mustafa from Nigeria. We've got a very international audience here, Professor.
Yes, this is open civilization. <isn't
it? laughs> Open civilization. We got Nigeria, and then we got Pakistan after that. Okay, so Brother
Mashallah. Nigeria. This is the benefit of digital transformation. Yeah?
Absolutely. Okay, Brother Mustafa,
Assalamu alaikum, Prof. Assalamu alaikum, Prof.
Assalamu alaikum, Prof. My salam to Nigeria from Istanbul.
Wa alaikum salam. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to ask this question. What we have noticed is this increase in restrictions with regard to what we can teach and how we can teach, especially when you look at the way we teach social and natural subjects. They are getting tighter regulations and insistence on you must teach this subject and this is how you want to teach it. For example, this issue of sexuality education or sexual education, as it's called, and there's a prescription in Nigeria. There, something came out before there was an uproar about how to teach even Islamic studies and how to teach this sexual education. And it was back and forth and back and forth until the government had to wade into this. But it's still going to come back. They're just going to repackage it in a different format, in a different way. And so how do we go about, you know, teaching this social and natural so without getting into trouble with the regulating body?
Yes. During the colonization period, education is used as a tool, you know, to indoctrinate non-Western people and make them intellectually dependent on the West. So that's why they strictly imposed what to teach and how to teach. You know, they wanted like Muslim teachers in Islamic schools to teach their students this materialistic, Eurocentric, atheistic understanding of science, you know, and also this liberal ethics based on autonomy of the individual, based on relativism, moral relativism, moral subjectivism, right? They want to use education, you know, as a tool, you know, to spread this Eurocentric understanding of the world and ethics and society, nature, you know, to the whole world and make them intellectually dependent on the West. So and we have to be critical of this approach. So if something is empirically proven, we must respect. You know, it's empirically proven. You know, there is data supporting it, then we accept it. But when it comes to the interpretation of those empirically proven facts, we have to have our own interpretation. Okay, as I have mentioned in my presentation, you know, empirically discovered facts are interpreted in different ways. You know, depending on people's worldview. You know, I mean. Like there are schools of thought in physics, in chemistry, in biology, you know, and the same discovery is interpreted in opposite ways, you know, like in sociology, in political science, you know, I mean, these are all scientists, you know, and they are in respected universities, but they have opposing views when it comes to interpreting the facts. So, I mean, we should have our own interpretation of those empirical facts, because if there is diversity, even among the, you know, the dominant and hegemonic schools of thought, why can't we have our own interpretation, right? But wholesale rejection is not a good idea, because then you are rejecting something you should not reject, because it's already, you know, empirically grounded and proven. So this would be wrong. Wholesale acceptance is also wrong, you know, because in the wholesale acceptance there is, you know, empirically proven facts and their interpretations, right? So we have to be critical but fair, you know, critical but fair, and I believe this is like a very objective and honest view, you know, to what's offered, you know, to us as science. And it would be very helpful to adopt comparative education as a method. Comparative education. First, present the opposing views in the West on the same subject, okay? So this way you relativize them. You know, the students realize, wow, this is not the single view. There is no single view. There are opposite views. You know, different interpretations, competing interpretations. Then you say, okay, this is how we Muslims approach the issue. Okay, so this would be very important methods, comparative education. You know, comparative education as a method. You know, so comparatively presenting what's in the West, and then presenting the Islamic view. And you tell the students, you choose what you want, okay? You know, and no one can object, because you are not imposing one view. You know, you are presenting all of them, and Muslim students will naturally choose the Islamic one anyway, right? Okay, thank you.
Shukran, thank you so much. Let's go to our final question, which I thought was from Pakistan actually, because we have a regular from Pakistan, Sheikh Jahangir. But this is a different Jahangir. So Jahangir Akbar, who I believe is from the UK. Assalamu alaikum, brother Jahangir. I'm going to unmute you now. Over to you. What's your question? Your final question for this afternoon.
Assalamu alaikum, Professor. Assalamu alaikum, everybody. Jazakallah for Trinidad Trust for arranging this. It's a brilliant session, mashallah. Professor, it's been absolutely brilliant. Jazakumullah khairan for your contribution. It's absolutely, mashallah, really, really wonderful it is. Professor, where do schools start if they want to implement an Islamic ethos, an Islamic curriculum? How do they, what steps should a school take to start bringing this into action? That's my question.
Like each school must assess its own resources and abilities and make decisions. What I offered here is a framework, you know, setting some goals, and if you set these things as your goals, you can gradually make progress towards it, because these things takes time. You cannot do it overnight. You have to work on it. You have to reform your system gradually, but it's very important to have this as an ideal, you know, as values, and make a strategic plan, you know, make a strategic plan, you know, to implement these nine values, and look at your resources, look at your people, look at your staff, and look at the people, you know, who can help you in transforming your education system, both the organization and the content. Then this how you continue, but at the same time, it's very important, you know, to incorporate both formal education and informal extracurricular education. Okay, education is not limited only what we do in the schools. I mean, education is 24 hours by 7, you know, all the time, everywhere. And extracurricular education is also as important as the formal education we offer in the schools. So the sohbet, you know, spending time together, socializing, is very important, like in the evenings, during the weekends. Even when you go to picnic, you know, like students learn how to share, how to help each other, how to serve each other. So it's very important. Because education in Islam, min al Mahdi ila al-Lahd. You know, so the first person, you know, who came up with the idea of mandatory education in the world is Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because he said, "Talab al-ilm faridatun ala kulli Muslim wa Muslimat." So this is mandatory education, you know, and on both men and women. You know, mandatory education, because maybe Brother Baber, you know, studied in history how mandatory education emerged in the West and how French, you know, applied it for the first time. This is a Eurocentric view. I mean, mandatory education first implemented by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, and how many years was it, Brother Baber? 5 years, 6 years, 7 years? No, it was min al Mahdi ila al-Lahd. From cradle to grave, you know, lifelong education, you know, lifelong mandatory education on both men and women. So that's the Islamic understanding of education. It's very comprehensive, it's continuous, and it's not limited only with the school. If we adopt this perspective, inshallah ta'ala, from this holistic perspective, we can help our students grow both academically as well as socially, morally. You know, they will develop their IQ and EQ, you know, emotional intelligence. You know, become good member of society, become a good friend. You know, and they will learn, you know, how to make sacrifice for others, how to spend time together. They will learn how to become a good team member, because becoming a good team member is the key for success, inshallah. So I emphasize not only the school education, but also outside school education. Thank you.
Okay, jazakallah khair, Professor Rajab. We're going to leave it there because we have gone over slightly. I know there's so much more information. I know you could probably talk for the next 10 hours and we would all stay here listening to you. I'm sure. Now, I know that a number of you have asked whether there are slides available or recordings available. Just to mention, there is a recording, inshallah, that we will make available to you. I know there's lots more information. I'm pretty sure we'll all be going back and watching it 2-3 times, taking notes, inshallah. So don't worry, that will be available for you in the next couple of days, inshallah. Just to also mention that next week, remember, this webinar is a weekly webinar. We started 6 weeks ago. When the COVID-19, you know, we were all in lockdown, etc. But we have decided to continue with that, inshallah. Even though the in various countries the lockdown is easing, we are going to continue, inshallah, for at least the next 6 weeks, and then possibly after that we'll have it monthly. But the next session, which is the same time next week, Thursday, 4 o'clock UK British summertime, and we will be discussing a similar topic to today, actually, which is how do we embed tarbiyah in our teaching practice? how do we embed tarbiyah in our teaching practice? And that will be led by Dr. Abdullah Shahin, who is the lecturer in Islamic education at the University of Warwick. So inshallah, we will advertise that during the week, inshallah, so please do join us. Once again, Professor Rajab, it's been an absolute pleasure. I know you're a very, very busy man. So thank you so much for accepting our invitation and delivering such a wonderful presentation for us. And so
thank
many
you.
Of us,
inshallah. I give my best greetings, my best prayers to all our brothers, sisters, friends all over the world. May Allah keep you in good health.
Ameen. Ameen, inshallah. And apologies to those of you that I know had lots of other questions I had in the chat box. Unfortunately, we have run out of time. Inshallah, next time. Until next time, everyone, take care of yourselves. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.